Well, I'll tell you what, this movie has caused quite the upset. People are not happy. They say the plot is ridiculous, that it's trying to be something that it's not. They hate the story, they hate all the creative choices, they hate everything. But I'm gonna be straight with you. I don't think you quite understand what you're watching. And unless you're like a super fan like myself, you don't have the right. You don't have the right to speak about things that you don't understand. Which is why I'm here to educate you, punk. I am ready to take a stand and defend its honor. So let's dive right in to what was the best movie I have ever seen in my entire life. Cats. I have always been a huge fan of theatre and musicals. When I was young, I would watch two musicals religiously: Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat and Cats. Cats is based on a collection of poems written by T.S. Eliot. The music is composed by Andrew Lloyd Webber. It premiered in 1981. It is the fourth highest grossing musical of all time, behind Wicked, Phantom of the Opera, and The Lion King. Which, by the way, means it has made more money than shows like Les Mis, Miss Saigon, and Beauty and the Beast. The main theme and message of this musical can essentially be boiled down to: don't be a racist, don't judge a book by its cover, include others. The whole plot of Cats can be written on the palm of your hand. Once a year, the Jellicle Cats come together for the Jellicle Ball. What makes a Jellicle Cat unique to other cats, you might ask? Well, according to Andrew Lloyd Webber, absolutely nothing.
All cats are Jellicles, you see. This is made clear in one of the unpublished poems.
Yes.
Well, all cats are Jellicle cats, fundamentally.
The Jellicle Ball is a night of performance and competition between all the characters, all getting a chance to share who they are. And at the end of the show, one of the characters is selected to and be taken to the Heaviside Lair, which is some sort of cat heaven or reincarnation or something. As a kid, I always assumed that it was like a second chance to be good. Each character volunteering to be sacrificed to their gods gets their own unique song. Most of the songs are super high energy, the choreography is incredible, the singing is beautiful, and most of the characters do absolutely nothing to move the story forward. There are only four characters that actually do things. Old Deuteronomy is the old wise cat, which gets to select which character is going to die. Macavity is an evil psycho cat who wants to ruin the Jellicle Ball. Mr. Mistopheles is a magic cat who ends up saving the day. And Grizabella is an outcast from the group who just wants to be accepted and loved and touched. And by the end of the show, she's not only accepted by the others, she ends up winning the entire competition and is selected to die. Pretty much every review that I've seen of this movie so far has come from people who have never seen the show or didn't like the show in the first place, saying things like the plot is boring and the CGI is uncomfortable and it's all awful and the characters make no sense. And to be honest, a lot of that I would agree with, but I didn't want to just jump on the bandwagon of hating something before truly understanding it. And while it's completely fair to judge this movie compared to all of cinema, I didn't want to do that. I've decided to do a very detailed analysis of what this movie is, and instead of comparing it to literally every movie that's ever made, I'm just going to be backing it up against the stage show. I don't want to review it as just a movie. I want to discuss and analyze whether the choice to make it into a movie improves the value of the show or makes it worse.
It makes it a lot worse.
This review is split into two parts. The first part is my review and analysis of the 1998 film release version of Cats. I would watch this over and over and over as a child. And the second part of my review is going to be of the movie. And I'm not just going to complain and whine over the fact that the film's bad. No. I'm gonna go over every character, every song, every moment that I can squeeze out of this. I am going to do it with all my strength because, damn it, I love this musical. And it deserves proper, authentic feedback. So with that, I'm sending you to Joel from the Past, where we begin part one of this very comprehensive waste of time. I have not watched my original VHS copy of Cats in quite a long time. I'm seeing the new movie in a week, So I thought it would be a good idea to relive my childhood. It's a good idea to refresh my memory before going into what is going to be, according to all the reviews, hell. I am officially a React channel. A Laserdisc. Is that what this is? Image. Image what? Image. The finest in home entertainment. I like that. I remember, as a kid, this was terrifying. This was so scary. Can you imagine just these eyes that have no bodies, just floating around? Listen to this. It's so good. It is so good. This goes on for a long time. Wait for it. Alright, so first thing I love about this show as a show, it's all set in one giant dumpster. It's awesome. And that is something I'm really looking forward to with this upcoming film, is the giant sets. Very excited to see how they use those. They've looked really, really cool in the trailers. Monkey strap. Skimble shanks. Yeah, I wonder if they're gonna open it like this.
Are you blind when you're born? In
the dark.
Can you look at a king?
It's so dumb.
Can you say that you're bite?
You gotta admit, it's catchy. Even though they're talking absolute nonsense. It's so catchy. It's such a good opening number. It's so fun. That's weird. They sound great. There's no doubt that the music is fantastic. Okay, so apparently that's funny. I bet you that's really funny actually watching it on, like, on stage. But I've never laughed at that anyway. They sound good. Okay, so obviously we all know what has happened to the look and feel of the CGI rubbery furry cat things which have been plastered over top of the performers in this new upcoming version. In this, they look fine. They look like stage performers. It's like, it makes way more sense. And back into it. It's intense, man. They're so hardcore. It's so energetic. Man, it must be exhausting. Wait, remember this. Oh, it's high. Okay. Pay attention to this. This is very important and why I think that the movie's not going to do well and why this does well, okay?
There's a man over there with a look of surprise, as much as to say, well now, how about that? Do I actually see with my own very eyes a man who's not heard of a genical cat?
Okay, that is super important to kind of affirming this idea that these characters are here to put on a show. Like, they know this. They know, they're very self-aware of what's going on. Because there's the plot, if there is one. And then within that is there's this kind of objective, this goal to perform and to present. And so they're aware that they're being watched. It's very important to recognizing that why this show does well is because it's not real life. And they know that. This is their opportunity to express themselves, to be noticed, to have a voice, and to share their story with the world. These characters know that they're not trying to be real. And that's something that I'm worried about this movie that's coming out is going to try and do. The whole point of the show is for it to kind of be open to interpretation. It's ballet and dance and singing and theatrics. And therefore, they leave things out. They don't specifically try and make everything work. And I think that's part of the reason that I loved it as a kid was because there was so much about it that isn't explicitly talked about, but you can kind of make up and assume and you know, create your own story out of. Now the show's going to introduce us to Victoria, who doesn't say a thing in the musical. She doesn't say anything. All she does is dance. You must need a lot of strength to be able to hold some of those poses. I don't... Okay. Okay, so now they start to introduce the cats that are volunteering for this little cat competition. And the first one is being played by that chick from Pitch Perfect. It's a catchy song. So this is literally all it is. It's just catchy songs and fun. And it's great for a show. It's very entertaining for a show. Is this going to reflect well into a movie? I don't know. Now this always confused me as a kid, and I still don't understand this. I wonder if they're going to do this. She just like... Okay, so just to get this straight, she like wears a coat? Is that what it is? Is she just big because she wears a coat? Or, and whose coat is that? And do we need to be concerned that she's a murderer? The tapping is cool though. Choosing to cast that chick from Pitch Perfect to play Jenny Anydots, I'm concerned about that. Partly because Jenny Anydots clearly has a kind of authority to her. She's one of the older ones, she's wiser in the group, and you feel that in the song and how she kind of leads and takes care of the home that's described in the song. So choosing to cast that Pitch Perfect person concerns me because I think that she's too young, and I think that she's got this kind of clumsiness to her, and you see that in the trailer. She's got this kind of silly clumsiness to her, which I don't think is going to pay off well as far as translating the song, unless of course they change the mood and vibe of the song, which would be a real shame. That's big number one for me. I don't think that's good casting. I'm very nervous about that. I hope that they can prove me wrong. God, these dancers look so good. I can't remember what happens after this.
Yeah.
Right.
If you're up on their pheasant, I'd rather have grouse.
Oof. Okay, hold on. This guy, this is my second favorite character in the show, and his voice is unbelievable in this. Man, it's so good. Who is this guy? I want to find out. John Partridge, good on you, bud. You have an awesome voice. You suit this character so well.
Put me in a house, I would much prefer a flat. If you put me in a flat, then I'd rather have a house.
Sometimes it needs a curious cat.
And there isn't any call for me to shout it.
Okay, I will say this now. I'm surprised how often my parents let me watch this. The tone is... how do I put it? It's not G-rated. So I'm very surprised at how often my parents let me watch this. Again, I watched this a lot as a child. Yeah. This is very funny. I always thought this was very funny as a kid. That's gold. That's very funny. Okay, so Jason Derulo is playing this character, and I don't think that's a bad casting, because obviously Jason Derulo can quite easily do the kind of the player thing. Oh, I'm awesome and everybody look at me. That's not hard. What is hard though, and what comes with this character, you'll see it a little bit later on. He kind of takes on this persona of, even though I act like the best and I pretend to be the best, I know I'm not the best. I know that the best is this other character called Old Deuteronomy. And so he has this kind of respect and awe, and he takes care of people when he's called upon to do it. So it'll be interesting to see if Jason Derulo can pull that off, both the coolness and the carelessness and the recklessness, and also the responsibility that this character does eventually take on in this show. Note here, these ones here, these are the oldies. These are the ones who have been around for a while and are like, oh, what a disgraceful young boy. and you'll notice one of them is Jenny Any Dots. But in this upcoming movie, Jenny Any Dots is being played by this younger, irresponsible child. So, well, we'll see, but I don't know. It worries me. And there isn't any need for me to spout it. What is this? Oh, God. Okay, so... I have a Bible here in case I feel I need it. What is this? Ugh, there's really no explaining that. That's weird. God, I wonder how much of that they're gonna have in this movie. You know, in all honesty though, has this sort of thing really got away? I mean, you look at the most popular trending YouTube music videos these days, and I guarantee, like, most of those would be just as bad, if not worse, than what you just saw right now. So yeah, this is weird, but it's not like it's foreign. It's not like we're not used to that sort of thing. Just focus on how good the song is. Ooh. Now we actually get some plot development here. It's good. They actually space it out pretty well as far as, like, just random songs about cats and then moving the story forward. Hello, Elaine Page. Yeah, I wonder how they're gonna do this in the new movie. So they have this whole, oh, she's a bad cat, nobody go near her. And then there are these younger kittens, as you can see here. Oh, actually, no, this one's just playing a prank. This mean kitten, bad kitten, no. Oh, that's good. Okay, so just to explain what's going on here. This is Grizabella, who's this kind of outcast. I don't know why. I think maybe, like, this isn't explained. I don't think this is explained. Maybe it is. She's this cat who used to have a really good life, and now she doesn't for some reason. Either life was just cruel to her in the end, or she made some bad decisions or something. I don't know. She's not liked. And it's not really explained why. And you see this kind of, this tension within the group, because you have the people that have been around for a while that are like, no, 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 she bad. And then you've got the younger kind of characters, the kittens, who don't know her very well. And they're being told, like, don't go near her, she bad. And nobody really explains why. And so it's quite interesting. I think it reflects society. Really? Have thought
I don't remember this.
It's a good song.
So who have they got playing her? Jennifer Hudson? I don't know much about Jennifer Hudson. Is she an actor or is she just a singer? It doesn't matter. I don't think that's necessarily a hard role to fill. You just need a really, really good voice and somebody who can act sad. So it's not too bad. So I don't think that's going to be a problem. I'm sure she'll do fine as Grizabella. It'll be interesting to see how they incorporate her into what has become all of a sudden a very dialogue heavy plot in this new movie. You know, on the stage show, it's a case of, well, you can just use your imagination to figure out whatever happened to her and why don't they like her and things like that. So I really hope that they kind of keep that mystery, but they probably won't. Whatever this new movie is trying to achieve, it's not trying to be subtle. Let's put it that way. Hey, it's my boy. This one's fun. I think that's proud. Buster for Jones and White Spats. Okay, so James Corden has been assigned to play this role, which is, again, I'm very nervous about, because this is supposed to be a wise, authoritative, we have huge respect for this character. And from what I've seen in the trailer so far, he just seems like a greedy, selfish, I'm James Corden in a cat suit. I don't know, that just seems like a terrible, terrible decision. And again, why I think that this show would be doing a lot better if they had cast people that we didn't know, so that you can focus on the characters as opposed to the actors playing them. Imagine James Corden and then listen to just a little bit of this guy.
Visits are occasional to the senior educational, and it is against the rules.
See, look at this. He's very Carrion is a good character, but I don't think James Corden can pull this off. Good voice. I give my Benson. Real good voice. Good luck, James Corden. Ooh. Now it's getting good. This is terrifying. Sometimes when I was a kid, I'd like fast forward this bit because I'd on my VHS be like, nope. And then, oh, it was a fake out. It was a fake out. Sneaky. This is one of the best scenes in the whole show. Oh, it's so cool. All right, so we thought that we were going to be seeing the bad guy. Turns out it's just these two mucking about being all mischievous. So they have just very subtly, it's very subtle, introduced the bad guy without introducing the bad guy, which shows just how much of a threat the bad guy is. Now, I'll get to the bad guy once he actually shows up. But they've started to plant the seed in everybody's head that the bad guy is bad, and he is bad in this. He's very bad in this. It's awesome. But for now, Monk and Jerry, Rumpeltaser. Very impressive choreography. I don't know who they've cast for these two. I assume that they're in it. They better be keeping the song. It's such a good song. You can't just cut a song like this. But again, how do you incorporate this and give reason for this scene to be in the movie? For them to keep it in the movie, they need to have reason, so they're going to do something dumb. I'm not looking forward to that, so I'm worried that they're going to create this convoluted, messy, gross plot that doesn't help it at all. That is awesome. That you can't deny. If they don't have that in the movie, then it's dead to me. They're busted! Notice they don't run off, because they're still part of the pack. They're just cheeky. And that's important, because recognizing that those two are misfits, but they're still welcome. They're still part of it. Whereas Grizabella, Yeah, she's not allowed. This is a good song. This is a happy song. Now, note something here. Rum Tum Tugger is back. And he's talking about somebody else. And he's showing this respect. So if he's talking about somebody like this, must be a big deal. Because you heard the song before, and now he's... Anyway.
Can it be really... Yes,
I remember being so excited every time, because you couldn't see, so there's this anticipation of we don't know what's coming on stage, but something cool, it's gonna be cool clearly because they're so excited. I love it. For a stage show, brilliant. And there he is, woo! Big guy. It sounds so good. Oh, his harmony is so, so good. And look, ah. They've got Judi Dench playing this character, which I think is a good choice. They need somebody old and wise, and she's old and wise, and it's kind of the extent of this character. Well, this character is the Christ figure, almost quite literally. Spoilers, but I think it's a good pick. I'm excited to see how she does that. I'm worried that they're going to give her too much dialogue. There are things that happen to Old Deuteronomy later on in the show, which happen and it's crazy. And I'm worried again that in the movie they're going to ruin it by creating all this dialogue and things that are unnecessary. Hey, and now they're all happy and celebrating because they're at a ball. So. I'm wrong. This is a different scene. Okay. This is a weird scene. I enjoy this scene very much. Okay, so Munku Strap is going to tell this grand story, and they're gonna perform this kind of... This is kind of meta, because it's a stage show, and now the cats are putting on a show for Old Deuteronomy. I imagine they'll probably cut this. This would be the first most obvious thing to cut from the movie. But basically he tells this cute little story about dogs. It is always the same wherever one goes, and the pugs and the palms are the most people say that they do. Yeah. So they've got Mung and Jerry and Rumpelstiltskin dressed up. You get to see a lot of how Munku Strap his character kind of works in this. He's a leader and a director and a guider and a protector of the kittens and blah 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 blah. You see, he gets frustrated at them during this time because they do things that they're not supposed to in this little play that they're doing and things like that. None of that comes through in, like, dialogue. It comes through in the physicality and the expression and the dancing and the singing. Oh, there's Candy Cane. This is always so funny. It's a little Candy Cane. Hey, and he's back. Oh, he's there. So now I guess they're just doing more celebrating. Just dancing around. This is what this is, right? It's a giant dance show. Woo! What is this? once again, this. All right, back into party mode. And now back into party, and she's not welcome, and that's sad. It'd be cool to see how they do all this. I hope that this is well done. I know it's gonna be super distracting because they're gonna look really strange. I turned 21 earlier this year, and at my birthday party, a lot of videos played because all my life's been on video. And at the start was a bunch of old VHS tape stuff, and while it was playing, this song was playing behind it. It was rocking. It was great.
What is that? What is this? What is this? It's so bizarre and crazy. And it must be so cool to see it live. I've never seen it live. I need to see it live. The music's interesting because I always, when I was a kid, I remember thinking, oh, is she like a bad person? It's very somber music, almost a little scary. Kind of makes you confused on what to feel about her. Trying to remember the good old days when she was some sort of runway model or something. But you see, no dialogue, just somber, sad music and very good visual performance. Makes it very clear what she's trying to get at, and this kind of hopelessness behind it. It's sad. Sad song. And notice old Deuteronomy in the back. No talking, again no talking, but she doesn't look. She just... Very important visual there as far as explaining who this guy is. So, he's the Christ figure. He's the one which wants everybody included. He's the one which wants to bring the widow and the sick and the poor and the leper to the table. And you can see that in how he feels about Grisabella feeling like an outcast. Moments of happiness. I don't remember this bit at all. What? He's got a good voice. I don't know what this is about. So I guess he's teaching them something. I like this one. This is very wholesome and sweet. So Gus is being played by Ian McKellen. I don't have much to say about that. I think it's a good choice. I think out of all the casting, this is the one that I think is the best, most suited. And he's going to do very, very well. As a performer, I mean, he's going to look weird, obviously, because they all look crazy. In a regular troop, and they think they are smart. It's so sweet. This is cool. So he's not there. He's got this kind of ghostly thing going on here. So it's Gus. It's Gus remembering something from his past, because he was a performer. Shed. They better keep all this as it is. This is perfect. Back to happy again. That's one thing that this thing has going for it. It's very mood swiggy. It goes from very sad to very happy for almost no reason. So, Skimble Shanks is a fun song. This is the one that gets a pass as far as being silly, in my opinion, because that's kind of the point of the song. He's goofy. I don't know who's playing this, which, once again, good. It means that I can focus on the character instead of the performer. So yeah, I'm looking forward to Skimble Shanks in this movie. I think it's going to do well, because I don't know who it is. Such a good score. The songs are so good. And they put together the train. And this was awesome. This is so cool. They just have this giant train prop, and they all do different parts of the train. They better do something like this in the movie, because this is sick. This is awesome. It's such a good show. And they should have kept it that way. This entire video is just me going like this, right? This is how I feel every song. And now he's back. And you can hear him laughing, and he's don't know where he is. So scary. Oh, I'm so terrified. Okay, so that was the bad guy. Mr. Elba is playing McCavity. When I first heard that that's who they had cast McCavity as, I was like, oh, cool. Yeah, he's got the physique. He's got the threat. He's the grr. He can do that. But since watching the trailers, I'm concerned. The whole point of this character is that he's supposed to be this menacing threat that is reckless, totally reckless. That's kind of what's so crazy about this, is that he's just this bad dude who's bad for the sake of being bad. And I'm really, really worried that what they're gonna do is take this character and give him like a reason. And from what I can see in the trailers so far, it's because he just wants to be the one that's picked. It makes him just a whiny character who's not getting what he wants, instead of this crazy menacing threat who just wants to wreak havoc for the sake of it.
McCavity's a mystery cat. He's called the Hidden Paw, for he's the master criminal who can defy the law. For when they reach the scene of crime, McCavity's not there.
Okay, so here's something I love about this song and the way that they've done this song. We have seen so little of this villain, right? And now they have a song about him, and he's not there to like show this. So you need to show it through the stories of the other characters sharing their experience of it. Makes him super mysterious and threatening and really, really interesting. And from what I could tell reading online, sounds like they're gonna get him to sing this song with Taylor Swift, which is such a bad idea.
McCavity, McCavity, there's no one like McCavity. He's broken every human law. He breaks the law.
He's broken every human law. What a crazy character. He's broken every human law. Every human law. Here we go. Let's see what McCavity has done. Manslaughter. Kidnapping. Oh, he has done kidnapping. We've seen him do some kidnapping. Cyberbullying. Conspiracy. Child abuse. Bribery. Arson. Aggravated assault. Vandalism. Homicide. Wire fraud. Extortion. Shoplifting. And driving without a license. So, he's a bad dude.
You would know him if you saw him, for his eyes are
so. So this is a good opportunity to talk about Taylor Swift's character. In this show, she's kind of a supporting character for the main cast, and so this is an example of that. She supports Rum Tum Tugger in his song, and now she supports McCavity in his song. So I'm afraid that whatever they've done to rewrite this story, they've made her almost one of the figureheads of the whole thing. It makes me very nervous that they're gonna completely lose this character in the process. Apparently, they've written a new song. I won't judge them writing a new song immediately because it sounds like she's done it with Andrew Lloyd Webber. I'm worried about how they're going to mess up this character the same way that they're clearly going to mess up Jenny Any Dots and Bustaford Jones. And now he's back. He's back. And this is when you know he's a bad guy. Because you don't just give back the thing that you stole. She knows. Boof! It's him! Scary! He hasn't said a thing yet, just a reminder. He's kidnapped their leader, he's then skinned their leader and worn him as a coat. It's crazy! He's such a crazy bad dude! Oh, I wonder how they'll do this in the movie. Will Munku Strap be the one to fight him? I hope they give Munku Strap his time to shine in the movie. This is really it. This is when he gets to protect his family and... Ooh, it's awesome. It's so good, but how are they gonna put this into film? I don't think they can do it. Old jury on me's gone. They don't know how to bring him back. That whole sequence better be impressive in the movie, otherwise I'm gonna be really disappointed. Oh, but now we get to my favorite part of the whole show. Because this is when it just gets ridiculous. so ridiculous.
The greatest magicians have something to learn from Mr. Mistopheles. And we all say, oh, well, I never was there ever.
Oh, it's so good.
So clever as a magical Mr. Mistopheles.
This song is so good. They better not mess this up, because this is such a good song. This is my favorite part of the whole show. And he just shoots lightning from his head! I don't know who's playing this cat. I don't want to know. I... kind of shy character throughout most of the film, and then just kind of explodes, so I really hope that they sort of like really show that he's a nervous character right up until it's time for him to really do his thing, which is bring back the leader to life. I sang this song for an audition. What was that for? That was for Beauty and the Beast. I was auditioning for Chip the Teacup. I was like 9. Look at him go. Ah, I love it. Now this is weird. This is always, I've always found this to be quite strange. And down she goes. And it's obviously not her. It's so dumb. Oh, it's so good. Yay. And now he's like, oh. Remember what I said earlier about old Deuteronomy being the Christ figure? Oh, then, hear this. Yes! This is well shot, considering they committed to doing it on the stage and shooting it as it is instead of... And that's really what this new one should be. It should be just a bigger stage.
Who can now be reborn and come back to a different...
Now he's gonna make his choice. And look at him. Look how he's like so indecisive about who to pick. And here's that eerie song again. Oh, I hope they keep that music in. What'd she do to them? I wonder, for her to deserve this. Ah, now you see that? Keep watching, because after memory, that's when Victoria comes into play, and it's very important.
Memory, turn your face to the moonlight.
Looking at it with slightly older eyes now, I realize... See what old Deuteronomy's doing is giving her shot. And she comes very humbly and honestly. And she's just herself. She's a authentic, broken self. Oh, and she's dying. I don't know. She looks like she's dying. I always thought she was dying in this moment. And then she hears one of the kittens. That's a good moment. It's good. She crushed it. Elaine Page, man. I assume that that's the moment that everyone's like... I mean, it's not for me, because I didn't really care about this scene as a kid, but I understand why this is like the big moment for everybody. Like... And now... This is the key bit, okay? Aha! Here she comes. Bingo! Okay, Francesca Haywood? Is that who it is that's playing Victoria? Earlier I was talking about how Victoria doesn't say anything. I think it's a smart idea to make Victoria kind of the point of view person. It's about seeing her perspective of it all and seeing... And the story follows where Victoria goes and things like that. That to me makes sense from a plot perspective, because then you can see her journey and her understanding of what's going on. I think that makes sense then, that it would get to this point, she'd be the one to... I don't know if I'm making any sense here, but anyway, Francesca's like the best ballet person in the world or something. And I just hope that they don't give her too much dialogue, because that would be a shame, I think. I think one of the things that makes Victoria's character here so intriguing and fascinating is how much she's able to communicate to the audience, like, without saying anything. She even talks in the trailer, so I don't have a lot of hope for it. But anyway. And now for some reason, she's just all good? Why are they all of a sudden all good with her? What changed? Was it just her singing ability? But I don't want it to be explained to me, because it's so beautiful. So I don't want anyone to ruin this by, like, explaining why they're okay with her. This is so great. This entire... Now, this is great. This next bit. I can't even explain what this is. Up she goes. Floating tire. It's fascinating how they're all just stoked for her. After all of that. There is... this giant cat paw. Don't understand. That's the funniest thing. So what is that? Is that a cat paw? Is that a... Oh, I assume she's dead. She's dead, right? Are they sacrificing her? No, they're not sacrificing her. It certainly seems like it, though. Takes her away. Sounds great, though. It's a great song. And then there's this bit, which I don't really care for this bit. It's kind of over for me. He just sings another random song. And this doesn't really have much to do with what just happened, but I think it's direct from the poetry, so. It's not a bad finale. It's a bit... Oh. I'm sure that's quite big when you're in the audience. Skip, 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 skip. And they're all very proud, even though they've just been fighting to the death, and then one of them did die. Classic, like, 1990s freeze frame. And that's it. That's Cats. And then there's the credits, where they play that same song. Elaine Page. Dude, so good. Music is so, so good. It'd be interesting to see how well the sales do after the movie's released, like for the Broadway show. That'll be fascinating. Okay, I'm gonna go through the trailers now for the movie and just very quickly rattle off the things that I'm nervous about, the things that compared to what I just watched, Okay, so the environment looks awesome. Okay, so obviously it doesn't look good, and I don't want to talk too much about this. I'm going to tolerate it in my viewing. It's not really what I'm going to be interested in. I'll talk about it if it's distracting. I'm really hoping it won't be. I'm hoping that I'll just get used to it, but I guess we'll find out. Earlier I talked about how the characters kind of know that they're performing. It's kind of part of the story, is that it's their night to perform, it's their night to put on a show. This movie would have been a heck of a lot better if they had just gone with some really good costume. I'm just hoping it's not distracting. That's literally my only hope. I'm hoping that I can just get used to it quickly so that I can focus on the music and the dancing and the plot and the dialogue and all that, because that's what I care about. So that looks like Munku's strapped there. Probably welcoming her to, like, the...
I haven't seen you before.
Okay, so already Deuteronomy's talking, and I hate it. Because they're not supposed to talk, they're supposed to perform and sing and dance. I really like what they've done with the set stuff. I think that's going to be one of the strengths. You know, because the stage show is one set, and so what they've done is they've taken the concept of one set with massive props, and instead they've just made everything huge.
Here we go!
Rebel Wilson, that's her name. She's got a good voice. So yeah, Jennifer Hudson still looks weird, but I don't think she looks as weird as the others, and I think it's partly because she's got this kind of frizziness on the back of her head, and so it kind of makes it look more unrealistic, which does it a favor. I'm guessing that final shot there is them saying goodbye to her.
Let's dance!
I'd like a cat by its soul.
Plenty of soul.
Oh, okay, I don't like that. It makes McCavity seem way less of a threat if he's just a whiny little baby, which I hate. I hate that he's talking. I hate that he's got so much interaction with them. He's supposed to be this giant, crazy... I'm very upset.
What's your name?
Cat got your tongue?
Here we go!
That was a cool shot. That was not. What was that? Is that McCavity? So how do you go from this to this? Oh, it's so bad. Oh, what have they done to him? That's so awful.
Don't mess with the crazy cat lady.
And again, she's the silly one who does the...
Right, well, that's not going to work, is it? That's what I say to you.
Cross paws.
So, regardless of the fact that it's going to look very strange, I'm hoping that the performances will be well done, with the exception of the couple characters that they have totally destroyed by giving them ridiculous dialogue. I think the thing I'm hoping the most is that they don't try to answer all the unanswered questions that come from watching the show. It's not supposed to be a movie. It's supposed to be dance and ballet and music and singing. So I'm just hoping that all of that stuff is at the forefront. Now I'm going to pass you back to Joel from the future, who's off to watch the movie.
Well, today's the day. And I'm genuinely nervous about it. I know today that my perspective and understanding of this musical is going to change forever. And to be honest, I don't want it to. It's given me so much joy and life over the years, and so I'm upset that today that's going to change. The reviews have been intensely negative, and rightfully so, but it's pretty insane to feel like literally everybody in the world has united to hate something that I really like. And I know the solution to not letting that get to me would be to try and separate, you know, the movie and the musical. But that's pretty hard. It was difficult enough trying to explain why I enjoyed the show. Now, that's probably going to be impossible. Before I head out to watch it, I wanted to play this tune one last time, with the memory that I have of this show before it changes forever.
You've been hearing a ton of stories about how terrible the new Cats movie is, but I can assure you, it's worse than you're imagining. Everything looks terrible in this movie. It looks awful.
Not good, not fun time that I can't understand what the point of making it was.
Not everything should be translated to film.
Not every book can
easily become a movie. Not every video game can easily become a movie. Not every play can easily become a movie.
Cats is pure chaotic evil. Nothing makes sense, and I didn't know what to feel. I actually wrote down in my notes, don't know what I'm supposed to feel.
Was fine, but it's taken from something else. This is just an embarrassing movie that never should have been made, and I honestly am just baffled that it exists.
This is my second take of this review. I filmed this earlier. The camera was out of focus the whole time, and I talked for like an hour and a half. Still felt worse watching this movie though.
What?
Right off the bat, I wanted to say that I anticipated this was going to be a disaster, and I feared the worst, and I was quite surprised overall with how much of it I didn't hate. Now, there are a lot of things that I did hate, and we'll get to those. 10% of it, I actually thought was pretty great. And then 20% of it, I thought it was fine, maybe even good. And then the remaining 70% was anything between disastrous to just downright illegal. So, there you go. I think this movie would have been really, really good if instead of trying to be this giant Hollywood blockbuster film with crazy actors, it was just a lower budget stage film with a modern twist. That could have been quite interesting and clever. And sure, at that point, they would have then cut down the audience to just theatrical people. But perhaps if they did it that way, they would have actually, you know, made a profit. There was a lot of unnecessary dialogue and exposition, but to be honest, nowhere near as much as I was worried there was going to be. I saw a lot of reviews saying things like, oh, it's so frustrating because there wasn't any dialogue to move the story forward. And I thought to myself, good. As far as the CGI, the cats, in my opinion, looked most of the time ignorable. There were a couple of weird moments where it did look very creepy and like some sort of weird deepfake on a cat humanoid body, but to be honest, if you really want to talk about bad CGI, we have to talk about the cockroaches and the mice. Those were hideous. At least with the cats, it looks like they kind of thought about what kind of look they were going for. With the cockroaches and mice, I've seen better looking CGI in Super Mario 64. It was that bad. In general, they decided to go with shaky handheld cinematography, which is a bit of a double-edged sword because on one hand it hides the CGI, on the other hand it also hid the choreography quite a bit, and so it made it difficult to see what was actually going on. So that was a bit of a shame. The choreography itself was pretty good. There were some points where I think it would have been better if it was more ensemble instead of individual characters dancing. Occasionally they'd all do this weird thing where they twitch. I'm not entirely sure what that was and whether cats actually do it that way or not, but it was a little uncomfortable and a little bit strange. Almost kind of looked like they were possessed. The editing overall was fine. It was a little bit choppy at times. I think it would have definitely benefited from having a couple of longer one shots, particularly in the dance scenes. I just think this would have been a lot better if they were in costume on these massive sets. Speaking of set in this film, there were 9 sets. The main street, the graveyard, Trafalgar Square at nighttime, the Jenny Any Dots house, the milk bar, the trash cans in the alleyway, Mungun Jerry and Rumpel Taser's home, the Egyptian theater, the railway station and the train, and you have Trafalgar Square at daytime. Most of these sets looked really exciting in the trailers, and then in the film, they were fine. Occasionally there was some weird scaling between the sets, the characters, and the props. It didn't always line up. The houses were pretty boring. Trafalgar Square looked pretty cool at nighttime, but pretty plastic during the day. I do think that if the characters were in costume, particularly the nighttime scene at Trafalgar Square, would have actually looked really cool. The best set was definitely the Egyptian theater. Probably because this musical belongs in a theater, not in a goddamn movie. Overall though, I felt like the sets in general and the settings in general were quite bland. And I couldn't put my finger on why this was until I started to see whole scenes in this film. And I realized that the problem was the lighting. In a Broadway show, you have the element of stage lighting. It's expected that the lighting will dance along to the music. The lighting is supposed to communicate information to your audience about what to feel, but when you're doing it in a realistic movie, you don't have that element to use. And so you're left with bland, boring lighting, which doesn't change throughout any of the songs. It lets the film down, and it definitely strengthens the idea that it should have really never been a film in the first place. A key plot element in this film is that McCavity is taking away all the characters who are entering the competition to a boat. And I hated this so much. Something that became very clear because of this plot in the story was that a lot of the big shot names and the big Hollywood stars only probably had like week-long contracts. They just came to do their one scene and then bounce. And it's super obvious. So Jason Derulo, Taylor Swift, Rebel Wilson, James Corden, and so on. I'm guessing that the reason they wrote the film this way was so that they could cater to them and what they needed. And it sucks. It sucks so bad. And it was so obvious and it hurt so much. It actually felt quite disrespectful. These actors would have never actually been committed to do what would have been required from them in the musical. They only just wanted to do little snippets, and so they rewrote the story to fit that. And it's garbage. It's absolute garbage. Most of the actors, overall, were not committed to what this should have been. Maybe if you casted people who were actually able to be there for every shoot and commit to the course of the entire film, then maybe you would have been able to get some character development. Maybe you would have been able to come up with some creative ideas for them to interact. Maybe we would have gotten to know them a little bit better. Maybe this would have been just a little bit more bearable if you actually grabbed people who were willing to commit to this. But nope, they just had to get all that money, all 15% of their budget. So that is probably the most disappointing thing for me watching this, was that they clearly sacrificed what could have been really artistic for just a cash grab. So now I'm gonna go into the characters and whether the actors played them well or whether they totally ruined them. And I've ordered this from what I thought were the best characters all the way to the worst characters. So the best character in this film was Munku Strap. Robbie Fairchild committed to this incredibly. It was awesome. Munku Strap in this film was just as good as he is on stage. Munku Strap has to sing and dance and act throughout this entire film, and there was never a time where it felt lackluster. Everything was spot on. If the rest of the cast were as committed to their roles as Robbie was during this film, it would have been a lot better. The only thing that was a shame was that they cut the scene where McCavity fights Munku Strap, which I think is a real loss. That would have been a really good moment for Munku Strap in this film, but they had to cut it because Munku Strap would have kicked McCavity's butt. McCavity sucked. So yeah, Munku Strap did awesome, was very happy with Robbie's performance of that. Munku Strap gets an A for sticking true to how that character is supposed to be, and it also gets a plus for the commitment that Robbie showed to the character. So A plus for Munku Strap. In this film, Skimbleshanks is very true to how he was on stage. Maybe a little bit younger, but not clumsy or silly like some of the other characters. He's professional, he's slick, he's energetic. The other characters give him his support that he needs to really shine. I was anticipating that he'd be good in this film, and he exceeded those expectations. Skimbleshanks gets an A. Ian McKellen was a great choice for Gus. He does have the added benefit of being the only one that actually performs on a stage, which I think just enforces how much of this needs to be on a stage. Don't have much to say about this. It was easily the best casting choice in the whole film. Gus gets an A. Judi Dench was a good choice for old Deuteronomy. She clearly had the respect of the ensemble. She sings her part really well. She's quiet and caring, and she's all the things that are needed for this character to do well. Old Deuteronomy gets an A. Okay, so now we're at Victoria, and it was a solid performance and commitment from Francesca. Obviously, her dancing was really good. The way they wrote this character and the way that she develops over the course of the film does make sense as far as creating a plot, but I would have absolutely preferred it if they figured out a way to show a lot of that without her needing to say anything. A lot of her dialogue was just sort of to set up the next moment, the next song. Things like, oh, who is old Deuteronomy? Oh, well, why don't we tell you in a song? Oh, how do you enter the competition? Ah, you sing a song, obviously. So overall, it's a good character, and Francesca clearly committed everything to this, which was really good to see. She's just let down in some places because of some really poor writing. So Victoria gets an A minus. Grisabella. Jennifer Hudson was a good choice for this character. She sings the song well, she commits to the emotion that this character is feeling. It turns out that the biggest problem I had with this character was that she just looked too, believe it or not, normal. She didn't really look run down or like she was damaged, she just kind of looked sad. I think to really enforce her character, she needed to look just a little more disastrous, a little more ugly, for us to really understand why she's an outcast from the group, and for us to really feel for her more. So yeah, a good performance overall, but let down a little bit by the fact that she didn't really look how Grisabella should have looked. So Grisabella gets a B. Mr. Mistopheles. Laurie Davidson did a good job with this considering what he was given. Sadly, he was given a lot of extra things to do, which sort of made him just as clumsy as Jenny Anydots and Bustopher Jones. I did like that his magic wand was a pencil. His magic wasn't exactly impressive or exciting. It took him like 20 tries to get Judi Dench back. Wasn't a fan of that, ruined the song. He sang his own song, which, while not the worst performance in the film, did make the tone of it relatively different. So yeah, the character did have a bit of a rewrite. Wasn't a huge fan of it. But with that being said, Laurie did clearly dedicate himself to this role, and so for that I give him props. So Mr. Mistopheles is a B, maybe a B minus, not sure. Rum Tum Tugger, Jason Derulo was meh. He was never gonna be able to bring it to the same level as John Partridge. His voice was fine for the song and he had enough charisma and energy to keep his scene up. But after that, he just kind of disappears. We see a little bit of him after his main song, but not enough really for me to feel like he owned the character. This is what I was saying before about big hotshots showing up for their number and then leaving. He doesn't sing the Mr. Mistopheles song. I really wish he sang that. So like, not terrible, but not really good either, and definitely not enough for it to be Rum Tum Tugger. So Rum Tum Tugger gets a C+. Mungunjeri and Rumpeltaser, they were fine. Pretty forgettable, not very interesting. Partly due to the fact that their song was quite different in this version compared to what I'm used to. Not exactly cheeky and fun, they were more annoying and stupid. They helped McCavity with his evil plot by accident. So, I don't know, didn't really feel much for them. So Mungunjeri and Rumpeltaser get a C-. Alright, now we get to the really bad ones. Bustopher Jones. James Corden did a better job in the Emoji Movie than he did in this. As expected, he was the very definition of a bad one-liner. I hated everything that he did. His character wasn't funny, he was just greedy, he had no respect or dignity the entire time. It was awful. I wished James Corden good luck, and apparently that wasn't enough. Hope his paycheck was worth it. Bustopher Jones gets an F. Alright, McCavity. Oh, McCavity's an awful cat. They decided to make McCavity's motive in this film, if nobody's there to be chosen, it'll have to be me. So the whole movie is about him stealing his competitors and putting them on a boat. He isn't scary. He just sort of whines and talks about how much soul he has and puffs smoke and that's it. Pretty much everything he did I hated. Instead of trying to be terrifying, he was trying to be charming and it was unbearable. He failed miserably. I'm sorry, Idris Elba, I love a lot of what you do, but what they got you to do for this movie was a complete and utter failure. So McCavity gets an F. Bomb Ballerina, as I feared, was completely changed for this movie. So all I can say is that I was incredibly disappointed to see that they took the character and just made it McCavity's side bae. In the stage show, she has her own kind of personality and history, and she knows about McCavity because of her past, not because she's a bad cat. And in this, they just threw all of that out the window, and now she's just a goon. She's a servant. Taylor Swift could have actually done this character quite well if she was part of the group the whole time, but nah, she has other more important things to do. So she just showed up for her one song and then bounced for the rest of it. It was just a decision that they made so that they could cater to Taylor Swift's schedule, and I hated it. So Bomb Ballerina gets an F. And finally, this is the big one. This is the one who absolutely just destroyed my entire soul every time they were on screen. Jenny Anydots. Rebel Wilson was the worst casting choice in this film, and the character was presented very poorly because of it. She couldn't sing her own song properly. The coat that she wears that she takes off was just like a thin layer of skin. It was super weird. Her one-liners and jokes were all terrible, and they were all interrupting the songs, and it was super jarring and uncomfortable. And as predicted, she was clumsy and silly the entire time, and none of the characters had any real respect for her. Rebel Wilson ruined the character the moment that she was cast, and it's very clear that they catered to her needs instead of the other way around, which was incredibly disappointing. And so Jenny Anydots gets an F minus. Yes, it was that bad. Alright, so those are my thoughts on the characters. Now I'm gonna go through the songs and the scenes. The film opens up with a shot of the moon, and in the clouds was this cat face. I did actually enjoy this opening number a lot. It created a good setup for Victoria's character. Considering that the musical doesn't have much story, I thought that this was a pretty good setup. It also helps create some story that they can then use for the next couple of songs, so it was a good start. The way that the cats all approach Victoria was fine, and I thought that the energy was really high. The song itself stayed pretty true to what it sounds like in the show. I think it may have been cut down a little bit, which makes sense because you've got to cut things down for time. The next song was a slightly different tone. Instead of asking the audience these questions, they're asking them to Victoria, so that made sense. The vocals were mostly fine. Sometimes they didn't quite line up with the choreography. It felt a little bit studio recordy. The shoe didn't fall. That joke wasn't in it. I guess that makes sense. The brass instruments in the song weren't as strong, and it was a little bit more kind of electronic. There was some kind of EDM garage band drums in it at times, and occasionally it felt a little bit too quick. At the end of it, McCavity shows up and starts talking to Victoria, and it was at this point that McCavity was immediately ruined, and it physically hurt watching them have this conversation. Then we got into the naming of Cat's song, and they started with this unnecessary exposition about cats' names, but once they got into it, I thought that this was quite well done. They did speed the song up, and at first that felt a little jarring, but then it kind of made sense in the rhythm I got used to, and it felt quite high energy, even though it's supposed to be very kind of delicate and quiet. So it was a good mix, and I thought that was done pretty well. And then at the end of it, Victoria gets an opportunity to do a little bit of ballet, and that looked fine. I mean, obviously it didn't because of the CGI, but the performance itself looked fine. The invitation song started with Mr. Mistopheles just announcing his name. That made no sense. Monk Who Strapped In sings the song, and it's pretty similar to the stage show. And then after that, they just talk about what he just said, and that was a big waste of time. Then we get introduced to Jenny Anydots, and Monk Who Strapped's part of the song was fine. He kind of starts off a bit awkwardly with, "Hey, how about I introduce you to one of the competing cats?" Which was kind of silly. But then he starts the song, and the song at the start sounds good because he's singing it the way that he should be singing it. And then Rebel Wilson sang the song by herself, and it was awful. She didn't get any support from the ensemble. So instead of lines like, "She's completely concerned," it's, "I'm completely concerned." And it changed the tone of it completely. There was no kind of backup or support for her. It was just her talking about how great she was. It changed this tone of the song from a celebration about her to just me, 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 me. Also, she couldn't sing the melody correctly. It goes up quite high and she couldn't reach it, so they had to change it slightly, and it was noticeable and it was uncomfortable, and oh, it was ugly. It was not fun, not fun at all. And during the times where she really needed support, there was nothing. There was no harmony, there was nothing. So there was no energy. It was very silly, it was very dumb. There was absolutely no respect for the song, no energy. Just no good, nothing good to say about it.
Then Rum Tum Tugger shows up and gets to do his song, and he has a funny moment at the start where he criticizes Jenny Any Dots, and I liked it because I hate Rebel Wilson. The instrumentation overall was pretty good in this song. The choral bits were a little bit weak, so Jason Derulo is carrying this himself, and he manages to do that okay, but only when he's not getting interrupted by Rebel Wilson's jokes. There's also a bit during the song where Jenny Any Dots is captured by McCavity, and then it just goes back to the song, and that's so bad. So yeah, it was good, but it wasn't great, and a lot of that was to do with the fact that it kept getting interrupted. Then we have the song Grizzabella the Glamour Cat. The song was well done, probably because they stuck pretty closely to how it's done on the stage. Jennifer Hudson sings it fine, it's fine, she does a good job. The only real letdown in this scene is that at the end there's this conversation about who she is, and Munku Strap says something like, she's an outcast because of her relationship to McCavity? So you telling me that, like, she's not welcome to the group because she was in an abusive relationship? Is that what she is now? What? And then we get James Corden's Busta for Jones. And just like Jenny Any Dots, the song is changed. A lot of the lines go from he is to I am. It's not good. It's way more arrogant, and it doesn't give anyone else opportunity to support him in the song. It's ridiculous. This song is also interrupted by multiple terrible jokes, and James Corden doesn't sing this like a wise old figure. He sings it like a greedy psychopath. And at the end of the song, McCavity shows up and takes Busta for Jones away to the boat. So to put it simply, pretty much every time a song is over, McCavity shows up to ruin it. Then after this, we got Mungun Jerry and Rumpelstiltskin's song, and my heart broke when I heard this. They used a different version of the song. I think it might be the original version of the song from 1981. It's not bad, but it's nowhere near as good as the 1998 version. It has way less energy, it is way less engaging. They don't do any of the cool acrobatic stuff. They jump around a little bit, but besides that, it's just them knocking things over and sneaking around. I said earlier about how if they don't do the cool cartwheel thing, then it's dead to me. Well, it's dead to me. The tempo is slow, and it remains slow the entire time. There's just no fun. There's no thrill. The choreo was very subpar. I was furious. Then we get Old Deuteronomy, and this song was pretty well done. Munku Strap does a good job with it. It's a shame that Rum Tum Tugger wasn't there to support him in it. Judi Dench sings her bit fine. This wasn't as big of a moment compared to the stage show. I think that might be because of the instrumentation. It was just less dramatic and exciting. Overall, it was good. It was fine. It was whatever. What happened after that? We've got Old Deuteronomy and then... Oh, right. There's another character. There was this other character called Growl Tiger who hangs out on the boat. He gets his own little song. I think it might have been from a version of the musical, but I'd never seen it. He doesn't do anything. F. Gets an F. Then we get the Jellicle Ball scene, which is the big dance number of the film. The song is sort of split up into three parts. You have the setup of the ball, you have the weird twitchy bit, and then you have the fun choreography. Part one was really, really good. They're being all like, Jellicle cats are white and black, and Jellicle cats are rather small. And they sped it up and they gave it momentum, and they did this as they were getting ready for the show. It was a bit like in Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, how the dwarfs sing, hi ho, hi ho, and they just repeat that while making their way home. It was a bit like that. I really enjoyed that. I thought it was a clever way of getting that and condensing it down to a scene that made sense. The second part was fine. It was a little bit strange. I already mentioned it. It's sort of ballet, but with like twitching. So they were like kind of possessed or something. I don't know. But the final part was pretty cool. So Rum Tum Tugger shows up briefly to say, let's dance. And you know, then they get into some choreography and the music is high energy and it sounded really good. I just wish that they had stage lighting. I wish that it was on a stage. There was a weird thing that I did notice during this though. You could hear their breathing. Like you could hear them. It was
It was kind of distracting and uncomfortable. Then at the end of this, Victoria gets some sort of social anxiety and runs away. And she goes out and finds Grisabella out next to a lamppost and hears her singing Memory. And this was good. Jennifer Hudson does a good job. It was appropriate to have her singing it outside the theater where no one could hear her. And then Old Deuteronomy comes to the window and Victoria's outside listening to her. And I don't know, it was fine. It was good. Then after this, Victoria sings to Grisabella, Beautiful Ghosts. And it was super unnecessary. It was essentially Victoria just saying, I used to have nothing. But then I got this job. This fam. Yeah, it doesn't do much. Francesca sings it fine and then they move on. It didn't need to be in the movie. Then after that, from the window, Old Deuteronomy sings The Moments of Happiness. This song comes immediately after Beautiful Ghosts, and to be honest, I feel like you just get the same message. So I think that just one of these two songs needed to be cut, and I think I would have kept The Moments of Happiness because then Judi Dench gets to do a little bit more in this film. Judi Dench sings it fine. She clearly has empathy for Grisabella in the scene, and it's nice and it's simple as it should be. Then we get Gus the Theatre Cat, and I really liked at the beginning of this when Mr. Mistopheles and Gus have a little bit of interaction. It was a nice touch of character development that actually did work, so I thought that was cool. This song worked really well. It was nice and simple and stuck to its roots. The only real thing that changed was Gus did sing this whole thing by himself, a bit like how Jenny Anydot sings the whole thing by herself. The difference was Gus doesn't need support because everybody clearly respects him in this scene enough that he can carry this moment himself. And it's also quite nice and simple, so it makes it pretty easy for him to be able to do it on his own. He was clearly admired by the ensemble. It was wholesome and brilliant, and I just wish that they didn't look so ridiculous. And at the end of the song, Mistopheles does some cool lightning effects to really give it that punch at the end of the song, and it was cool. And then at the end of it, Gus walks off stage and McCavity's there to take him away. Also, quick note, McCavity doesn't take away Rum Tum Tugger. Why is that? Why doesn't he take... Anyway. After that, we get Skimble Shanks. And this scene is what this entire movie should have been from start to end. It is a real shame they only used this style for one scene. Monk Who's Trapped begins the song, and it is a very strong performance from him. It's also, I think, the strongest ensemble performance. The instrumentation to the song was definitely the best out of all of the songs, partly because they stick really true to its roots, but also when they make changes, they keep that energy up really, really high, and I loved it. Skibbleshanks did a great job. Can't remember the name of the performer, but very, very talented dude, totally crushed it. At one point, he started to tap dance, and I was nervous about this at the start because it looked like it was going in a weird direction. But then his tapping got quicker and quicker and quicker. And then as it got faster, I figured out that he was making the sound of the train going faster and faster. And so then as it got faster and faster, it sounded really cool. And then out of nowhere, just boom. And I was like, what? This is awesome. And then they do this transition from inside the theater to this railway scene. And it's so much more lively and bright and interesting and full of different color. And it was so much more engaging, and man, I just wish the whole movie was like this. And then they finish up the song, and at the end, McCavity takes him away, like all the other characters, but put that aside, everything else about this I loved. And then after that, Taylor Swift arrives, and she gets to do her one song and then bounce, and she drugs all the characters. Bomb Ballerina is so different in this film that when she sings the song, it just delivers a really different message. It's not really a song about how awful McCavity is. It's more of a song that's praising him. It's not fearful or spooky. It's more just like a girl gushing over a bad boyfriend. It's bad, it's real bad. I mean, the song itself, I guess, was fine, but I was so distracted by the fact that she was a completely different character. It was disappointing, it was very disappointing. And then at the end of the song, McCavity shows up and finishes the song with her, and it's garbage. And then McCavity starts whining like, you have to pick me, I'm the only one here and I've got plenty of soul. And Judi Dench is like, no, I'll never pick you. And then just poof, they disappear off to the boat to make her walk the plank. McCavity's Captain Hook. while old Deuteronomy is walking off the plank, we cut back to the theater where the cats are going, "Ah, oh no, what are we gonna do?" And then Victoria's like, "Wait a minute, we have Magic Cat. Magic Cat can do some magic." Mistopheles sings his song himself. It's not bad, but it is kind of awkward. This song would have done a lot better if Rum Tum Tugger was singing it. Even Munku Strap, if Munku Strap was singing it, it would have been better. I know Mistopheles is supposed to be shy, but not this shy. The song ends up being quite slow and low energy and constantly interrupted by Mistopheles trying to bring back Judi Dench and it not working. Yeah, I just don't like how they made him quite weak and fragile. And like he needed everybody else's support for it to work. And then by the time that it does work and old Deuteronomy does come back, which by the way took forever, so she definitely would have actually died, the song does start to ramp up a little bit, but it's still not enough and it ends very quickly after that. Oh, and also, for some reason, he doesn't bring back any of the other characters, so they just have to fend for themselves on the boat. I don't know, it's messy. It's messy and it was disappointing to see my favorite scene in the show get completely ruined. Victoria then goes outside to get Grisabella and brings her in to give her her shot to sing. It was a solid performance from Jennifer Hudson. She clearly gave it her all. I still prefer Elaine Page's voice in this song, or even Chad Graham's voice. I listened to that version a lot. The best part was definitely when Victoria joins her and supports her. And to be honest, I think that there could have been some real gold here if they had decided to just make Victoria's speaking role just this bit of the song, nothing else. If she was quiet the rest of the time and then just did a little bit of singing here, that would have been awesome. That would have been really, really cool, but they didn't do that. The response from the characters surrounding her after the song was fine, but nowhere near as special or as impactful as in the show. None of them got an opportunity to like accept her properly, you know, hold her hands or anything like that. Overall, solid effort. Then Judi Dench says, "You are the chosen one. You will bring balance." And then they put her on a broken chandelier and they lift the chandelier up, up, up. And then there's a big shot outside and it's a giant air balloon, which is whatever. And then they all go outside and they sing that whole, "Oh yeah," and at that point the characters who are on the boat have now escaped and joined them, so that happened. And then they sing the song, and the song's whatever. It's pretty similar to the stage show. It's big and dramatic, but not quite, because it's just more plastic. And they're all outside looking at the balloon float away, and then McCavity jumps onto a rope, tries to climb up to the balloon, and falls down, and it's all just so, so funny. I laughed so, so hard. And then we have the final song, and this was really, really strange. I thought that the intention behind this movie was to make it, like, I don't know, realistic? So why would you get Judi Dench to sing this final song directly into the camera? Like, why? It was a really bizarre choice. It was Judi Dench singing "Cats Are Not Dogs" to us. And the choral bits didn't help, and her bits went on for way too long, and it was very uncomfortable. And yeah, it was a very poor ending. Not that they had much to live up to. And then that's it, movie's over. There were a lot of times in this film where I would look at something and think, that's bad. But I wouldn't just think that's bad, I would think that's bad and I know how that could be fixed. Which was almost more frustrating, because now I have this vision in my head of what could have been better and what could have been really good, and I have to kind of carry that with me forever, knowing that that's not what we got. Before I went in to see the movie, I was nervous and I was upset because I felt like everything about Cats was going to be ruined for me. Oh, boo-hoo. But then afterwards, I actually felt pretty good, and I think the reason is because while I was watching it, I was just like, this isn't Cats. This isn't Cats. To me, it's just a poorly executed idea that they threw a whole bunch of money at, and they tried to turn it into something that it's not. we got a money-hungry, big-budget flop, and it got everything that it deserved. It's not Cats. It's not. You want to go watch Cats? Go to Broadway or wherever it is that the show is playing. All that being said, though, I do hope that some of those people, like Francesca Haywood and Robbie Fairchild, don't get hindered career-wise after this, because they clearly committed everything to this movie and made it just a little bit more bearable, in my opinion. So, that's my review of both Cats 1998 and Cats 2019. If you're still with me, hi, congratulations, you made it to the end. I think I can sum all of this up by simply saying, whatever you are, stay in your lane. Cats, you belong on a stage. You do not belong in a movie theater. Also, I just wanted to add that The Rise of Skywalker sucks!